Let's start with the topic. Today's topic is pharmacotherapy of urinary tract infection. So these are the points we are going to cover. That includes introduction, epidemiology, pathogenesis, definition, and drug therapy for the urinary tract infection. In the introduction part, urinary tract infection is the most common disorders, and normal urinary tract is generally resistant to the infection. Why it is so? Because in the normal urinary tract, the urinary pH is slightly acidic, which have its antibacterial activity. So that's why normally it is resistant to infection. In case of female urinary tract, it is more susceptible to the infection. Why it is so? Because female urethra have a short length as compared to male urethra, and that's why it is more common in the female. 50% of the patient predisposing cause cannot be demonstrated. In the recurrent urinary tract infection, it is essential to look for the predisposing causes. Otherwise, it happens again and again. Urinary tract infection may present itself as an acute infection and chronic infection. In case of acute infection, two general anatomical categories are there. One is lower tract infection and second one is an upper tract infection. Lower tract infection considered the infection restricted to urethra and bladder. That is known as urethritis and cystitis. While upper tract infection include above the part of the bladder. That is and that infection is known as acute pyelonephritis, prostatitis, intrarenal and perirenal abscesses. Now, what are the features and how the urinary tract present? There are differences in the presentation of lower UTI and upper UTI. So what happens in the lower UTI? There are patients present with the increased frequency and urgency of micturition, dysuria, pain in perineum, fever and chills and leukocytosis, which is observed in the upper tract infection, they are absent in lower UTI. That is the main differentiating feature. Infection is considered superficial or mucosal infection. Now what happens in the upper urinary tract infection? Patient may present with the loin pain, fever, chills and leukocytosis. Urine with pus cells, urine culture is positive and shows significant bacteriuria. And infection is tissue invasion. So these are the different features of upper and lower UTI. Now in chronic infection, polyuria and nocturnal frequency may be present, general loss of health and weight, anemia and hypertension are also present. Chronic pyelonephritis is an important cause of hypertension and chronic renal failure. Now what is about the epidemiology? So it is subdivided into catheter associated, that is nosocomial, and non-catheter associated, that is community acquired infection. Acute community acquired urinary tract infections are very common as compared to the nosocomial. When we are compare the gender, so in that case, in women, in 1-3% of the school girls, UTI is common, then increase markedly with the onset of sexual activity. Now what about in man? So basically it is seen in the first year of life and unusual under the 50 years of age. Asymptomatic bacteriuria is 50%, but uncommon among the men under 50 years and common in the women in 20-50 years of age group. Now, what are the etiology? So, among the bacterial infection, the most of the cases that among them 95% of organisms are gram-negative. Among the gram-negative, the most commonest one is E. coli. After that, Proteus, Klebsiella, Aerobacter, and Pseudomonas. Now the remaining gram positive, in that it include enterococci, streptococci and staphylococci. Now what is the pathogenesis of UTI? So it is the relationship between the specific host, which include genetic background of host, behavioral factors, underlying disease, tissue specific receptors, pathogen, which type of organism involved, presence of virulence factor, expression of virulence factors, and environmental factors. So the vaginal ecology, then anatomical or urinary retention, medical device. So all this reflect and determine the clinical outcome in case of UTI. Now, what are the conditions affecting the pathogenesis? So in the host factor, gender and sexual activity, pregnancy, obstruction in the tract, neurogenic bladder dysfunction, vasico-ureteral reflex, bacterial virulence factors, they are ultimately affecting the pathogenesis. Now, what about the catheter-associated UTIs? So, in that case, bacteriuria develops in 10 to 15% of hospitalized patients with short-term indwelling urethral catheters. Risk of infection in 3 to 5% per day of catheterization. Which are the organisms involved in that? Most common one, the E. coli, protease, Pseudomonas, Klebsiella, Cerevisiae, Staphylococci, Enterococci and Candida. They are the usual cause of this infection. Infection occurs when the bacteria reach the bladder by one of the two routes, either intraluminal route or periurethral route. Clinically, catheter-associated infection usually causes symptoms without fever, often resolved after the withdrawal of the catheter. In the patient catheterized for less than 2 weeks, catheter-associated UTIs can be prevented by the use of sterile closed collecting system, aseptic precautions, short course of systemic antimicrobial therapy. Application of periurethral antimicrobial ointments also prevent the development of UTI in such cases. Now, there are some definitions related to UTI. Now, when you call, there is a significant bacteriuria. So, when there is a colony count more than 10 raised to 5 per ml of a single species in a midstream clean catch sample, that is considered as significant bacteriuria. What is asymptomatic bacteriuria? Significant bacteriuria in the absence of the symptoms of urinary tract infection. Now, what is simple UTI? So, simple UTI may be mainly present with a low-grade fever, dysuria, frequency, urgency and absence of the symptoms of complicated UTI. Now, what is complicated UTI? So, complicated UTI is a presence of high-grade fever, that is more than 39 degrees centigrade, systemic toxicity, persistent vomiting, dehydration, renal angle tenderness and raised creatinine. Recurrent infection means patient may have repeated episodes of infection. Now, how to diagnose it? So, based on the clinical features and history, microscopic examination of urine, dipstick taste, culture and sensitivity. So, these are the parameters on that basis you can diagnose the disease. Bacterial counts are clinically relevant in the sample of midstream urine if there is more than 10 raised to 3 colony forming units per ml in acute uncomplicated cystitis in a woman. It is significant if there is more than 10 raised to 4 colony forming units per ml in acute uncomplicated pyelonephritis in women. It is considered significant when there is more than 10 raised to 5 colony forming units per ml or 10 raised to 4 colony forming unit per ml of midstream urine in a man or straight catheter urine in a woman in a complicated UTI. In a suprapubic bladder puncture specimen, if there is a presence of any count of bacteria, that is considered significant. Now, what is the drug therapy of UTI? So, first, the principle of the therapy. So, goals of the treatment of the UTIs are, first, you need to do symptomatic relief by altering the pH of urine. As I said that, acidic pH makes the have a more antibacterial activity. So, you need to provide symptomatic relief by altering the pH. Then, eradication of infective organisms. Prevention and the treatment of reoccurrence. So, in that case, you need to find out the relevant factors. Then, identification and treatment of predisposing factors. Now, general principles. So, what are the difference in the treatment modalities when there is a case of acute infection and when there is a case of chronic infection? So, in acute cases, an appropriate drug may be started as soon as urine has been collected for the bacteriological examination. But while in case of chronic cases, the mixed infections is more likely and concomitant renal failure may modify the drug therapy. So, in that cases, there is no desperate hurry to start the drug treatment before the case is thoroughly investigated. Drug must be used in adequate doses and for the adequate period. Growth of E. coli is optimum at the pH of 6 to 7 and is inhibited at pH below 5.5 and above 7.5. pH of urine must also be maintained at the level that would permit the optimum antibacterial activity of the drug used. Fluid intake, that is very important. Fluid intake should be liberal, as frequent emptying of the bladder that helps to reduce the bacterial count in urine, and as the growth of E. coli is reduced, of urine is very dilute. There is no satisfactory antibacterial drug to which all the strain of E. coli are invariably sensitive. Now, classification of drugs. So, there are bacteriostatic drugs, bactericidal drugs, and urinary antiseptic agents. So, which are the bacteriostatic agent? They are sulfonamides, tetracycline, and nitrofurantoin. Bactericidal agents include cotrimoxazole, ampicillin, extended spectrum penicillins, aminoglycosides, fluoroquinolones, cephalosporins, and in urinary antiseptics, it includes nitrofurantoin, methylamine, mandelate, and naledixic acid. Now, let's discuss the drugs. So, in case of sulfonamide, it is a bacteriostatic agent and most commonly used in E. coli infection. It is effective in urine and tissue level, but the development of the bacterial resistance is a major limitation of the use of the sulfonamides. Now, what about the cotrimoxazole? So, it is a potent and cost-effective bactericidal agent against the most common urinary tract pathogens. In acute uncomplicated UTI, it is used in the dose of 2 tablets twice a day for 7 to 10 days. In the small dose, it is effective in eliminating the chronic bacteremia. Trimethoprim concentrate in the prostate. Now, what about the ampicillin? Ampicillin is orally and parenterally used, and it is a bactericidal agent. Good tissue level, and it is excreted unchanged in the urine at a high concentration. Dose of 500 mg 6 hourly for 7 to 10 days is a recommended one. Useful for the treatment of UTI in the pregnant women, and hospital acquired infections are resistant. Now, what about the carbacillin? The dose of 1 gram 4 times a day is useful, and it is useful in the Pseudomonas infection. Now, piperacillin. So, it is also a broad spectrum activity against the gram-negative organism, especially the Pseudomonas. And it is useful for the moderate infection in the dose of 4 to 8 gram per day intravenously. For the life-threatening infection, the dose would be high, that is 12 to 16 gram per day. And its use should be limited to severe cases with the life-threatening septicemia. So, it is kind of a reserved drug for the severe cases. Now, aminoglycosides, antibiotics. So, it includes gentamicin and amikacin, effective against the E. coli, protease, and Pseudomonas, given parenterally and can cause ototoxicity and renal toxicity. Single daily dose can reduce the renal toxicity, but this group is also reserved for complicated UTIs. Now, what is the status of fluoroquinolones? So, they are the ideal agents for the nosocomial, pyelonephritis, and complicated UTIs. Norfloxacin, ciprofloxacin, ofloxacin, pefloxacin, and lomifloxacin. They are highly effective orally antibacterial agent. They are effective against the bacteria resistant to beta-lactam and aminoglycoside antibiotics. Cephalosporin, it is used in the infection with the E. coli and protease resistant to other antibiotics. It is a drug of choice for the Klebsiella infection. Third-generation cephalosporins are effective against the multi-drug resistant enterobacteria and Pseudomonas. And it is also useful for the septicemic urinary tract infection. Phosphomycin, it is also a bactericidal agent against the gram-positive and gram-negative bacteria. A single 3-gram oral dose is used to treat the uncomplicated UTIs in women. Antibiotic phosphomycin may be prescribed as a single dose treatment for the women who are pregnant. Nitrofurantoin, rapidly absorbed from the GIT, urine concentration high but poor tissue concentration. So that is unsuitable. So this drug is unsuitable for the renal parenchymal disease. It is used in the chronic suppressive therapy in the dose of 50 to 100 milligram per day for the several weeks. Single indication of nitrofurantoin is treatment as well as the long-term prophylaxis of lower UTIs, mainly due to E. coli, and that is also safe in a pregnancy. Now, nalidixic acid. So, 500 milligram tablets are available. Dose is 5 grams per day in 4 divided doses for 7 to 10 days, and that it is reserved for occasional cases with the infection with protease. Then methylamine mandelate, it is a salt of mandelic acid and methylamine, rapidly absorbed from the GIT and excreted in urine. At acidic pH less than 5.5, methylamine liberates the formaldehyde, so it makes urine more acidic. The dose recommended dose is 500 milligram 4 times in a day. Mandelic acid helps to lower the urinary pH, not active against the acute infection but used in the chronic suppressive therapy. Larger dose causes acute inflammation. Then phenazopyridine. It is a dye, exert an analgesic effect in UTIs. It provides the relief from the burning sensation, dysuria and urgency due to cystitis. It is devoid of antibacterial activity, so this drug is suitable for the symptomatic relief. Dose recommended dose is 200 milligram 3 times a day orally. Now, how we can make the choice of antibacterial therapy in case of UTI? So that is based on the site of urinary tract infection, means whether it is a upper urinary tract infection or lower UTI. Whether the predisposing cause such as diabetes or abnormality of urinary tract is absent or present, uncomplicated UTI or presence a complicated UTI, then whether the infection is caused by the drug sensitive or drug resistant organism. So based on that, you need to choose the proper antibacterial therapy. Now this is the table showing the empirical treatment of UTI. And that is for the acute uncomplicated cystitis. So there is 3 days regimens are there, which includes different antibacterial agents, in which trimethoprim sulfamethoxazole, trimethoprim alone, norfloxacin, ciprofloxacin, ofloxacin, levofloxacin, gatifloxacin, moxifloxacin and lomifloxacin. So all this drug you need to give on the 3 days regime. And 7 days regime, which include macrocrystalline nitrofurantoin 100 milligram 4 times a day. So this is the empirical therapy, but particularly for the acute uncomplicated cystitis. Now if there is uncomplicated cystitis in the woman, so if the woman have specific other factors like diabetes, other comorbid conditions, then symptoms persist more than 7 days, recent UTI, use of diaphragm, age more than 65, and pregnant women. So in that case, you need to extend the regimen. That is for the 7 days, which include amoxicillin 250 milligram 8 hourly, then cefoproxime 100 milligram 12 hourly, then trimethoprim sulfamethoxazole combination 160 to 800 milligram 12 hourly. Now, what in case of acute uncomplicated pyelonephritis? So that is for the upper urinary tract infection. So in the woman, most cases without associated clinical evidence of follicular and urological disease, mild to moderate illness, and no nausea and no vomiting. So for this condition, recommended drug is oral quinolones for 7 to 14 days. Initial dose given through the IV route if desired. Single dose of ceftriaxone 1 gram, gentamicin 3 to 5 milligram per kg, followed by oral trimethoprim sulfamethoxazole combination for 14 days. In case of severe illness or possible urosepsis, hospitalization is required. So in that case, parenteral quinolone, gentamicin 1 milligram per kg, 8 hourly, ceftriaxone 1 to 2 gram per day until this fever is subside. Oral quinolone, cephalosporin or trimethoprim sulfamethoxazole for 14 days should be continued. Now, what is the clinical management of the pyelonephritis? So, that depends on whether the patient is presenting with the symptoms and the signs of pyelonephritis or not. So, if the patient is presenting with the symptoms, so you need to do thorough investigation, you need to you need to admit the patient and start the parenteral therapy for 1 to 3 days, which can be from the fluoroquinolones, aminopenicillin, then cephalosporin and aminoglycosides. And after that, if the patient shows the improvement within the 72 hours, so you need to shift that patient on the oral therapy. And urine culture 4 days on and 10 days of therapy, urological evaluation if indicated. So that is about the patient present with the symptoms. And if that patient doesn't show improvement within the 72 hours, so in that case, total therapy duration should be 14 to 21 days. And if there is no improvement or deterioration, hospitalize the outpatient, review the culture and sensitivity, and evaluate the factors for that, and drain the obstruction or abscess. Now, if the patient doesn't shows the symptoms? So, in that case, need to do thorough investigation. But you can manage the patient on OPD basis. You need to give oral therapy, that is for the 7 to 14 days from the same group, that is fluoroquinolones, aminopenicillin, cephalosporin, third generation cephalosporin, trimethoprim sulfur methoxazole, only if the susceptibility of the pathogen is confirmed in case of cotrimoxazole. If patient shows the improvement, same, you need to continue the oral therapy, then urine culture 4 days on and 10 days of the therapy and urological evaluation if indicated. And if patient doesn't show the improvement, the same thing, OPD patient, you need to admit that patient, review the culture and sensitivity, and evaluation of the complicating factors. Now, what about the complicated UTIs? So, in mild to moderate illness, oral quinolones for 10 to 14 days until culture results and antibiotic sensitivities are known. So, in the severe cases, parenteral therapy should be started. In the parenteral therapy, you need to choose one of this drug, that is ampicillin, gentamicin, quinolones, ceftriaxone, ticarcilline, clavulinate, then imipenem and cilastatin. In the oral, you can choose quinolones or trimethoprim and sulfamethoxazole combination. Now, what is the management of postcoital cystitis? So, some women get lower UTI after every sexual intercourse, and that is most common. Initial treatment by suitable antibacterial drug, followed by 0.5% cetrimide cream in periurethral area before coitus and bladder emptying after every sexual act. This may be followed by single dose of ampicillin or trimethoprim sulfamethoxazole combination. Now, what in case of asymptomatic bacteriuria? So, it is transient and resolved without treatment. Removal of the catheter followed by the short course of antibiotic in case of nosocomial infection. If the catheter cannot be removed, then use of systemic antibiotic when the symptoms appears. Now, what in case of prostatitis? So, prostatitis is divided into same acute infection and chronic infection. The clinical presentation is quite different in both cases. In case of acute onset of fever, chills, dysuria, urgency, while in case of chronic one, the recurrent UTIs, obstructive symptoms, perineal pain. In case of prostate examination, you will find in case of acute infection, the prostate is tender, tense and boggy, while in case of chronic one, prostate appears normal. In case of expressed prostatic secretions, you will find in case of acute polymorph neutrophils and presence of bacteria in both cases. Etiological agents in both cases, most common when the E. coli and other uropathogens. And the treatment also doesn't differ much. In both cases, you can choose fluoroquinolones and other agents. Now, what about the urinary tract infection in children? So, in case of children, it is mostly seen in the first 3 months. UTI is more common in boys as compared to the girls, after which the incidence changes. So, in first 3 months, it is more commonly found in the boys as compared to girls. But after that, the incidence changes, that being more in girls than boys. Pediatric UTI is most common cause of fever of unknown origin in boys less than 3 years of age. The clinical presentation of UTI in infants and young children can vary from the fever to GIT symptoms, lower or upper urinary tract symptoms. Investigation should be undertaken after 2 episodes of UTI in girls and 1 episode in boys. Now, what are the criteria for the diagnosis of UTI in pediatric age group? So, urine specimen from the suprapubic aspiration, any number, presence of any number of colony-forming unit per ml is considered significant. Urine specimen from the bladder puncture catheterization, if there is a presence of more than 1,000 to 50,000 colonies per ml, that is significant. In case of midstream clean catch, if more than 10 raised to 4 colonies per ml with symptoms and 10 raised to 5 colonies per ml without symptoms, considered significant. Now, what is the treatment? So, treatment slightly differ from in case of simple UTI and severe UTI. If patient is having simple UTI, so oral therapy is needed. Parenteral single dose therapy only in case of doubtful compliance. So, which are the antibacterial agents? So, third generation cephalosporine and gentamicin. Oral therapy should be to complete 5 to 7 days of treatment. So, it should be continued for 5 to 7 days. If the patient is having severe UTI, so in that case, obviously parenteral therapy is needed until the afebrile stage. Adequate hydration is also important. You can choose the third generation cephalosporine, amoxicillin, clavulinate if cocci are present, and followed by oral therapy, which needs to complete for or extended for the 10 to 14 days of therapy. Now, vesicourinary reflex. So, 50% of the infants and 30 to 40% of the children with UTI and resolve with the age. Its severity graded from 1 to 5 based on the appearance of the urinary tract on micturating cystourethrogram. Grade 1 to 3 are more likely to resolve by themselves. So, here the management of the vesicourinary reflex. So, in grade 1 to 2, antibiotic prophylaxis until the 1 year old and restart the antibiotic up to 5 years of age if break the febrile UTI. What about the grade 3 to 5? So, antibiotic prophylaxis up to 5 years of age, consider surgery if breakthrough febrile UTI is there. Beyond 5 years, prophylaxis continue if there is a bowel bladder dysfunction. Now, what is the management of the UTI due to candidial infection? So, usually occurs with urinary catheters, typically after antibiotic therapy. At high risk are the patients who are immunocompromised because of the tumor, AIDS and chemotherapy. Asymptomatic candiduria rarely requires the therapy. Candiduria should be treated in the following cases: if patient is symptomatic, neutropenic, patient with the renal allografts, patient who are undergoing urological manipulation. So in that case, treatment is required. So what is the treatment? Catheter should be removed. Treatment with the fluconazole 200 mg once in a day for 7 to 14 days. IV amphotericin B and bladder irrigation with amphotericin B is required. Now, in which cases antimicrobial prophylaxis is needed related to UTI? So, these are the indications that women of childbearing age group, then catheterization or instrumentation inflicting trauma, uncorrectable congenital anomalies, inoperable prostate enlargement or chronic obstruction. So, in these cases, prophylaxis is needed. So, these are the drugs which can be given for the prophylaxis, and all the drugs given once in a daily at a bedtime. So that include cotrimoxazole 480 mg once in a day, nitrofurantoin, norfloxacin and cefalexin. So what is the conclusion? So care must be taken in assessing the individual patient. Whatever the drug you are choosing, that must be used in adequate doses and for the adequate period. Bactericidal drugs are to be preferred for the treatment as compared to bacteriostatic agent. All the pregnant women should be screened at first trimester and treated. For the nosocomial UTIs, prevention is better than the cure. So, this is all about the pharmacotherapy of UTI. These are the references. You can refer all these. Thank you.